President of the United States is called upon to make the right decision at the right time. And you've seen here tonight people who voted for the war, voted to fund the war, and now they have a different position. People voted for the Patriot Act. Now they have a different position. People voted for China trade. Now they have a different position. People who voted for Yucca Mountain, now they had a different position. Just imagine what it will be like. They have a president of the United States who's right the first time. Just imagine. And I don't think that the first questioner's question was really answered about what are you going to do about this president, and for that matter, the vice president, because they're out of control, and the Congress isn't doing anything.
Thank you, Congressman.
It's called impeachment, and you don't wait. You do it now.
Dennis Kucinich in 2007. Dennis Kucinich is waiting on the phone here. I'm Randy Credico, live on the fly, and I'm going to get right to Dennis Kucinich because I know he's out campaigning. He's running for Congress as an independent. He's been on the show many times, and I got a program in front of me from 1999, 25 years ago, where Dennis Kucinich was the recipient of the very, very famous William Moses Kuntzer Fund for Racial Justice Award. So that was back in 1999. We welcome him back. Good to have you back, Dennis.
Randy, wonderful to be with you and your listeners. I just want to bring you up to date on something that's happening right now. The House of Representatives has passed and sent to the Senate the bill, which is called the National Defense Authorization Act. And there was an amendment put in it in the House Armed Forces Committee, which provides for automatic registration to Selective Service for draft purposes, automatic registration for everyone 18 to 26. So you've got a draft dragnet where the U.S. is planning automatically to register 18 to 26-year-olds. And, you know, where, why would we be sending our kids to war? We ought to be opposed to automatic registration. Our government has to use diplomacy to avert wider wars. Congress has to reclaim its constitutional war power duties. We must not permit our country to wage undeclared wars. And the Founding Fathers provided for the common defense, but were opposed to conscription.
Wow.
So I'm just giving everyone
Well,
the
that
alert
is
right
really
now.
A shock. I mean, that's breaking news. You know, they were talking about that, but just what does that mean, Dennis? So it goes to the Senate. The Senate will pass it. The president signs it, and then everyone.
It's unlikely that this provision will be stripped from the bill in the Senate. And again, the House just passed the defense authorization bill, and it provides for automatic selective service registration, which then places each individual in the system for potential draft call-up. Now, previously, HRL males would, on their own instance, register with Selective Service. So I think what you should be asking, what the people are listening should be asking, why an automatic registration for the draft? This is a draft dragnet. It makes it easier for the government to use a multitude of databases to track young Americans for purposes of conscription. And there are serious constitutional issues here, Randy.
Well, who was the author of this amendment? Who actually put this amendment in there, or was it?
It was put in by a Democrat in the on the Armed Services Committee. So this is a Democratic amendment, and it passed on a voice vote. But it's in the bill.
I mean, so wait a second. This amendment was voted on by the entire House. Before it was put into the bill.
Here's the way it works. A bill gets amended in committee, and it goes out of committee with all the amendments, which then go to the floor of the House. And there's also an amendment process out of the Rules Committee, which can add additional amendments. But this was put right into the bill out of Armed Forces Committee. So cut to the chase. this bill is going to the Senate, and it has a provision which provides for automatic selective service registration for 18 to 26-year-olds for purposes of a draft. So people have to start asking, why in the world is the government intent on doing this? And I don't think there's any question but that they're getting ready for a much bigger war, and they're expanding the pool and making sure that they don't miss anyone 18 to 26-year-old. And they're creating this big database of people. It used to be, you know, you sign up.
Right.
Selective service. Now, you're automatically in.
You're automatically in.
And the implications are the government has taken a step towards enormous power and authority here, away from the individual, and towards a collective insistence that I think raises serious constitutional issues, you know, including the Fourth Amendment right to privacy and the Fifth Amendment due process rights. So we're going to challenge this.
Right.
And,
wow.
You know, and there'll be a lot of information on my site at Kucinich.com. We're putting it up this afternoon. We're going to challenge this.
Right.
Because Congress hasn't declared war. We're in these undeclared wars, and all of a sudden we're going into a program which will provide for massive conscription. And this is not a small matter. It's not like, well, you know, everybody's signing up anyhow when they're 18. No, this is a shift. This is the government saying you're automatically in the system eligible for a draft, you know.
Even before you sign up. Even before you sign up for the draft.
They've signed you up.
They've signed you up. Now, what do you think the response is going to be by people between the ages of 18 and 26 when this becomes nationally known? What do you think the response is going to be? Because I have a feeling.
Go ahead. What do you think, Randy?
What I think is going to be, look, World War One, they declared war April of 1917, and then they had the draft. World War Two, same thing. The draft didn't come until after Pearl Harbor. Vietnam, I guess it stuck around, and it was because of the draft that there were millions of people on the street. So it's been in abeyance all of this time, and here it's coming back. I mean, you really, shocked me. With this information,
well,
I must tell you.
Randy, what they're going to say, what the government's going to say is, oh, we're not drafting anybody. We're just putting everybody's number in the system.
Well,
you know, and what's the system? It's selective service. It's a draft.
Right. So, oh, my goodness.
You know, people who support the government's position are just going to parse words and say, oh, we're really not going to do that. You may have signed up for the draft already. We never called you. No, we have multiple wars going on right now.
Right, but
Congress has not declared a position on it, but they fund these wars.
Well, look, if the president were to ask Congress to declare war today, I think 99% of them would say yes. There'd only be a few people.
But you know what? But that's what the Constitution's about. You know, then they have to account to their constituents. But right now, there's no accountability. The wars continue. We're paying trillions of dollars for wars, undeclared wars. It licenses the government to go anywhere they want, to spend any amount of money they want, to go after anybody for any reason without having Congress involved whatsoever. Because once Congress appropriates the money, court rulings have said, look, you basically have licensed the war. If that doesn't follow, though, that Congress doesn't have a responsibility under Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, this debate has to happen. And you can't have a draft and then you declare a war because that's what they're setting up. It's not like our nation is at risk here. No one's defined that America is at risk where we all come in to defend our country. That's not what this is about.
Yeah.
This is about helping to feed a machine with the blood of our young people, and we're just being pulled into this, and it's being seen like it's made to seem like it's a new normal. So the new normal is about to occur, which will be, oh, you're automatically registered. How about that?
Right.
Oh, really?
Wow. Jesus.
Really?
Wow. You know, the UK has, you know, floated the same proposition, reinstating the draft, the National Service Act, to bring people in. And I spoke to someone running for MP out of Blackburn, Craig Murray, last week, and he thought it was just, you know, a bunch of bluster and, you know, basically out there to, you know, to show their antipathy and the distaste for whatever is going on in Ukraine. But they don't have, first of all, they have very few soldiers in their standing army in the UK. And I think it's the same thing here. People are not signing up like they used to be in military
and
service.
That's why conscription, Randy, is being used. And this is, you know, you have to always look at the timing when these things happen. So at a time when the U.S. is involved in multiple actions, wars, they put this thing forward. Everybody's automatically registered.
Yeah.
So your number goes into the system. All your information goes into the system. And they've got you, and they'll call you up. And
well, Dennis, how long does it take to train somebody? First of all, you know, World War One.
Well, you know, we all know basic training, you know, is going to take months, but... Hey,
are we at that point? Is this kind of a gambit with the Russians? Another one. First of all, Biden signed a 10-year agreement. I don't know if you saw that. A 10-year defense agreement with Zelensky.
Yeah, I did. 10 years. So that means kids that are 8 years old right now might be subject to being called up to continue a war that should have been resolved several years ago through diplomacy.
Well, it was. It was resolved, and then Boris Johnson went over there and scuttled the whole thing.
Right.
You know. So, I mean, look, what I don't even know if it's useful to have soldiers, because if this gets any hotter, it's going to escalate out of control, and then we're going to see. For the first time, actually, for the last year, I've been like thinking about there is going to be a nuclear war, and now it's more than ever. Do you have concerns about that?
Well, of course.
Do you think it's real?
Of course. I mean, you can't. If anybody, let's say that Russia is already sending its assets.
Submarine and military, ships, freighters.
Now, these are issues that are not any different than the issues which arose in 1962 during the Cuban Missile Crisis between Russia and the United States, or the Soviet Union and the United States, and President Kennedy and the Russian leader Nikita Khrushchev.
Right.
They found a way to work it out. They de-escalated instead of escalating into a nuclear conflict. We have to look at the trail, at the narrative trail here, in terms of the United States overthrow of the Ukrainian government in 2014 and the effort that was about, which has been an active program to encircle and to interdict and to defeat the Russian economy and eventually overturn the Russian government. Well, that's not happening.
No.
And these games are being played that involve brinkmanship are not necessary. The problem, Randy, as you and your listeners, I'm sure, are familiar with, is the miscalculation that it can occur that can set off a nuclear war. It's very dangerous, and we shouldn't be doing any of this. We should be using diplomacy.
Well, why hasn't the president, why hasn't there been, not an olive branch, but just some kind of, we got to talk to Putin and sit down. Why doesn't somebody, Kennedy spoke to Khrushchev. Why can't this guy speak to Putin? He's willing to take a call.
Well, I think what's happened is that the United States has been increasingly in a military pose as opposed to diplomatic. And they've lost the capacity for diplomacy. And the military measures and sanctions are not going to work here.
Right.
I just wanted to give you a heads up, though, about this automatic registration for the draft.
Wow. Right. And well, that scares
me. It opens up a whole new discussion.
Right.
And so, you know, people 18 years old, you've had to sign up. But now everybody's in the pool, 18 to 26. And that opens up the government to be able to just grab everyone in that draft age, even, you know, without any undeclared war, without any declared wars. And we're moving into a militarization of our society. The economy is being militarized with over $1 trillion annually going for the Pentagon. There's little or no oversight of that money. These defense contractors are famous for shafting the taxpayers and marking stuff up 2 and 3 times. We're being taken to the cleaners at the same time. World peace is jeopardized.
Right.
Now, you know.
There's a guy in Ohio that seems to be pretty good on this issue, and that's been J.D. Vance. What do you think of his, he actually...
Vance has said some things that indicate an independence of thought on these matters,
right,
which is important.
Right.
Because this is one of the problems with partisan politics, because people just go along with whatever the, quote, party says, whoever the party is, that, you know, anonymous force that asserts itself and, you know, for private interest as opposed to the public interest. One of the reasons why I'm running as an independent, I'm done with the system that says there's only one way to look at something. There's only one way to think. And we're being told the choices now are you either have war A or war B, instead of asking, why are we taking this trip at all? Randy, right. I got to run. I got to run. Please ask your viewers to go to Kucinich.com. We're going to upload a petition pretty soon. People will be able to participate. This has to be brought to a national audience, and this is, we're starting with you, so that people can be heard and say, wait a minute, we know why you want automatic registration. Right. You're planning a larger war, and you want to use our sons and daughters to do this.
All right, so that's Kucinich.com.
Right, Kucinich.
All right, and
thanks, Randy.
All right, thank you. Thanks a lot. We're going to play a little Mercedes Sosa here, I believe. Or let's play the other one, the one that I have marked up there. We're talking about Cuba. It's Che's birthday today, Che Guevara's birthday. So we do have Silvio Rodriguez, El Duce Abismo, I believe. If not, we have Mercedes Sosa. We'll get right there. I'm Randy Credico, live on the fly, and you got breaking news there. And I'm sure you're not going to see that on Ari Melber's show at 6 o'clock. Are we set to go?
Yeah.
All right. We're going to be right back, and we'll talk a little bit more about this. We're going to have a former CIA analyst join us in a few minutes as well.
Amar, supón que me voy lejos, tan lejos. Que olvidaré mi nombre. Amar, quizás soy otro hombre, más alto y menos viejo, que espera por sí mismo. Allá lejos, allá trepando el dulce abismo. Allá lejos, allá trepando el dulce abismo. Amar, supón que no hay remedio. Remedio es todo lo que intento. Amada, toma este pensamiento, colócalo en el centro de todo el egoísmo.
All right, Silvio Rodriguez, I'm Randy Credico. That was Dennis Kucinich with some very breaking news. I don't even know if Larry knows about this, but we're going to ask. Larry Johnson is a former CIA analyst. He's got a show to do in about 25 minutes, so I'm glad we got him a little early here. He was on a couple of weeks ago. Larry Johnson, thank you for joining us. I know you're getting ready for the judges show.
Yes, I am. But thank you for inviting me. What did Kucinich have to say?
The NDAA just passed, and they have a provision that everyone has to sign up for the draft.
Automatic
registration for the draft.
Yeah, that'll get people focused on wanting to go to war.
I mean, the NDAA, the House just passed it with this amendment, which compels you. They got anyone between 18 and 26 is now on the draft registry. What do you think of that? Yeah. Why is that happening? And is that a shock to you?
It's Back to the Future. So if you recall, I think you're close to my age. I graduated high school in 73.
Right, 72 here, yes.
Okay, so you're a year older.
Yes.
But you and I both had to register for the draft.
Yes.
Back then.
I did.
And there was a lottery.
Right.
And I don't know where you fell in the lottery and determined whether or not you got drafted.
I was 22. I was...
And you got drafted?
No, I didn't get drafted, but you and I were the same year, but they had a standby draft. And I think my number was 22, and I got somebody in my neighborhood sent me a draft notice that I had been drafted. And it was a joke that somebody thought was really funny. But 73, I guess it was. I could tell that somebody did some cut and pasting, but I, of course, you didn't get drafted, did you? Your number was probably 275.
My number was too low, but okay. So why are we doing this? Well, number one, despite the spin that the Army's putting out right now, the other day, Secretary of the Army testified before Congress and said, oh, we're meeting our recruiting goals. Oh, yay. Well, what they did is last year they wanted to recruit like 70,000, and they fell short. They only got about 55,000. So they decided, okay, here's what we'll do. We'll lower our recruiting goal to 55,000. That way we can say, hey, we're meeting our recruiting goal. But the reality is, they're not really meeting their manpower needs. So that's one of the reasons I think they're headed towards the draft. And frankly, though, I think it's great news. Yes.
It'll backfire.
The draft in require everybody to have to sign up, rich and poor, middle class, all races. And you know what? The politics about going to war are going to change real quick.
Right.
Because all of a sudden people are going to go, wait a damn minute.
Can you imagine all these yuppies out there? Imagine all these yuppies, these kids that, are totally oblivious to what is going on in Gaza and what's going on in Ukraine, with the bellicosity with China and Yemen and, you name it, Venezuela, there's hot spots, brewing everywhere. And, they'll have to learn about what they're signing up for. Is that what you're saying, Larry?
Yeah. Once they say, hey, I could get killed or maimed, they're going to go, wait a second. Let's slow this train down.
Yeah.
As long as it's the kids or somebody else that are dying, that are putting themselves at risk, it's fine. No big deal. That's okay. We can do that. But when it becomes to your own flesh and blood, when you got to put some skin in the game, okay, people get a little nervous at that point.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we're going to see.
How long is it going to take to train people? World War One. Draft began a month or so after the declaration of war against Germany, and they weren't deployed until like really the next year, and they were losing 100,000 people died in 100 days, 1,000 people. It wasn't like they were great, troops out there fighting. I mean, not a real professional army when it's drafted like that.
No, well, it is, the normal training cycle for a new recruit is 13 weeks of basic training. So, you know, 3 months, 1 week. And then once you're out of that, you go to what's called advanced individual training, AIT. And that's where you will apply, you know, pick up new skills, whether you're going to be in driving a tank or in an infantry unit or an artillery unit or a mortar unit. You know, you go, and that's another, you know, that could be 3, 4, 6 months, depends on the skill.
Wow.
So, you know, the United States is slowly coming around to the fact that it doesn't have, we don't have enough troops to back up all the wars we're trying to get into.
Well, Larry, wait, the thing is, even if we did, I mean, we're not going to be able to do a trench warfare like, the Russians and the Ukrainians are engaged in right now. I mean, you couldn't prepare them for that. I mean, they would be in a new meat grinder. So, I mean, let's be honest. This will be a missile-based, hot war. And then what is next? A nuclear war? They've knocked down parts of the Russian early warning system. I mean, where are we going right now? Where the hell? And then you got, one more thing. You got the president signing this 10-year agreement. I don't know if he floated that with anybody, with Congress or anybody else. He signs this 10-year agreement, defense agreement with Zelensky.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's the Biden administration is just out of control when it comes to, and it's both out of control and it's not rational, because we're trying to engage in potentially 3 overseas military conflicts, one in Ukraine, one in Israel, or potentially Iran, and another one in China. So that's possibly 4.
Yeah.
Well, hell, we couldn't even defeat the Taliban, number one, in Afghanistan after 20 years, and we can't even stop the Houthis. So who are we kidding?
Right.
This legacy of expeditionary warfare has just been a disaster for us.
Right.
Which, you know, again, brings me back. If just because we had a volunteer army, there was not really much political pressure brought on Congress to enforce the Constitution of having Congress declare war if we're going to be sending troops overseas.
Is there a lot of money in this for somebody in the military industry having a draft? I mean, tell me what we know. We have weapons that were given Ukraine and to Israel and other places, but what kind of new weapons and what kind of uniforms and helmets and all of that? Is there a lot of money in that?
No, not so much there. I mean, look, where the money's going right now, drones. There's a company out there that the stock ticker price, the stock symbol is AVAV. And about a year ago, their stock was selling at around $110.
Yeah.
Now it's up over $220.
Wow.
Why? Well, because as a result of the war in Ukraine, the U.S. military has come to recognize that the next war is going to involve a lot of drones. A lot of drones. More drones than we have right now. Up to this point, we've relied upon these big, like the Global Hawk or the Predator. You know, they're about the size of a small aircraft, or even in some cases a large aircraft. And that's, you know, we've been sort of conventional in that regard. But what's happened in Ukraine with the Russians and the Ukrainians both using what they call, FPV drones, basically a first-person point-of-view drone that you can, the operator sees where they're going and they can actually go fly into trenches and kill soldiers.
Yeah.
It's game changer.
Right.
A total game changer.
Was this all planned? Did the Pentagon like have this in the back of their minds, or maybe the front of their minds, when Lloyd Austin said, we're going to weaken Russia. And we've seen how this warfare has taken place over the last couple of years. And so you're sitting back seeing that. And so now you can prepare during that period of time, even though at the cost of 500,000, maybe I hear 600,000 Ukrainian lives, and I don't know where they're going to get the troops to continue fighting. So it's going to be just a trench. I mean, it's going to be drone warfare from this point on. Is that what the, was that the design all along, is to watch it play out and then engage now in a more you know, exaggerated way?
No, no. In fact, you know, the Austin Pentagon military planners, they had no idea. They genuinely believed that Russia was weak, that just a little bit of this military pressure with the NATO countries backing up Ukraine, that it would force Russia to crack, that the Russian soldiers would retreat, they'd run away, that the Russian general staff was incompetent, that nobody was capable of giving, you know, doing anything sound from a military standpoint, both strategy and tactics, that the industry was broken. Boy, did they make a mistake.
Well, you were just there in St. Petersburg, and our mutual friend Scott Ritter was not, but you were there. So you got, for a week, I've seen you being interviewed on this. What was your take, other than what you saw at the cigar bar? But you were involved in a lot of good discussions there, panel discussions. What was your take, the feeling of the people that you met there, the people on the street, and just the local economy? Was it shambles? I mean, I've been to Moscow. I haven't been to St. Petersburg. Just give us an overview of what you saw there, Larry.
It was comparable as far as, let's talk about the economic life of the average person. I live in the Sarasota, Florida area. It's one of the more, let's call it, upscale communities around Florida. I walk to I guess I call it the equivalent of Walmart or Price Club. But it was in St. Petersburg. It was three blocks from my hotel. So I walked in there to check it out. Good grief. The only difference between what we have in the United States and what the Russians had is they had more fresh produce. They had actual live fish in tanks, and the prices were a third to a fourth of what we paid.
Wow.
Other than that, it was you would have, you know, you could have been in any upscale community in the United States.
Right. And what about the subway system? I mean, I've been to Moscow, and the subway system, I just took the A train here to the station, and I got to tell you something, it could really use a lot of repair and cleaning up, and the trains do not run on time. You know, you wait and wait and wait and wait and wait, as you did in Casablanca, waiting to get out to a clipper to America. Let me ask you, did you take the subway system there?
I did not. I didn't know. I did take the taxi. They've got a Russia, through its, you know, their version of Google is called Yandex, Yandex. And they've got a taxi app on there that is very cool. And you click on it and say type in where you're going, and they give you a choice of the, you know, small, medium, or large, you know.
Yeah.
And you pick the kind of ride you want, and they'll tell you how much they're going to charge you, so you know how much money you have to pay the driver. And you can either put it on a card or pay them in cash.
Yeah.
Away you go. Wow. So, you know, that was good from that standpoint. I just said the important thing to understand is the public attitude in Russia with respect to this war is they are, in some aspects, becoming more frustrated with Putin for not being more aggressive. So Putin's restraint that he's shown up to this point is he's facing growing pressure to act with more aggression against the West.
Wow.
So
I mean, look, I when I was in Moscow, I got to tell you something. The people did not hate Americans. I had great conversations with, you know, I was all over that city. I was in Donetsk for a week, and, you know, people were very friendly with me. It's not like, you know, they've painted picture that Russians are these evil creatures, and they're not. They're sophisticated, and they're like us. It's like, you know, just like us. And here you got, so you got, you know, we could be going to war with people who are just like us. And it's, and the public here is pretty much in the dark as to what we're getting into. And really, as you said the other day, the culture, the history of this country, and it's like it really seems unified. And it's not like I don't want to seem like I'm anti-American, and you know, because I love this country, I love it. It's got a lot of problems I'd like to see fixed. One of them is the control over our purse strings by the military-industrial complex, and consequently being engaged in these conflicts.
Well, you know, if you're Caucasian, if you're from a European heritage, England, France, Germany, the reality is you could walk around Russia, as long as you dressed like them, without them visibly knowing that you were different than you were, quote, foreign.
Yeah. Well, but I know how you dress, Larry. You got that leather jacket on. You smoke.
But I was interviewed by a young German reporter who described to me his nervousness about coming to Germany, because he was really worried that he would be receive a very hostile reception. And he said he was just blown away how friendly, how kind, how generous the Russian people were with him. And he said the Russians draw a distinction between the government of Germany and the people.
Right.
And so they like the people. They hate the government, but they like the people.
Right. And now it does seem like it's ramping up or amping up, not just the rhetoric, but, you know, concrete things as the hitting Crimea, long-range missiles being okay to go into Russia. I mean, just take a look at that. Imagine, I think you said it the other day, if Mexico, you know, suddenly, you know, became an ally of Russia, and we put nukes there in Tijuana and aimed them towards Dallas or California. We've already got tons of nuclear weapons facing, and we have ships in that area. I think of the Baltic, Black Sea, all over the place. You know, they're talking about a couple of ships here, and everyone's getting alarmed, but, you know, they're not even nuclear armed, and people are getting nervous. Can you imagine what it's like to be in a country where you're surrounded by, like, all of these NATO countries with nuclear? Finland, which is right on the border, they're going to have nuclear weapons. Sweden's going to have nuclear weapons. Poland does. You know, Moldova, I think, does. You know, Romania. It's we're getting a taste of our own medicine right now, but just a small dose.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and the ships that are in the Havana Harbor, they actually carry hypersonic missiles.
Right.
And with conventional warheads, you're correct, they're not carrying nukes. But, you know, this was the second visit in a year. It was almost roughly a year ago that the Russians had made their first visit, and it had been several years gap. But Russia's actually been going, you know, the former Soviets were going to Havana with regularity back in the 1960s and 70s. So this. Part of this is what I view as Western media trying to gin up a threat.
Well, listen, well, how do we defuse it, Larry? I mean, why I asked Dennis, you know, why doesn't the president sit down the way, you know, 45-year-old John F. Kennedy did with Khrushchev? Why won't this president at least, you know, say, all right, we got it. Before it gets out of control. I mean, I am nervous. Dennis is too, for the first time. I mean, I was a while ago, but now more than ever about a nuclear conflict.
Yeah. No. It's we're as close to that as we've ever been, and that includes the Cuban Missile Crisis.
We're that close.
So, yeah. Yeah. I mean, the Russians have been, they're adamant. They're, because the West continues to escalate and continues to try to step up these attacks on Russian territory, Russia's going to retaliate. So they will hit, if, for example, the F-16s arrive at a base in Romania, and the first time they take off and cross the border into Ukraine, then the Russians will most likely, I guarantee it, they will attack and destroy that base in Romania. So now you've got
Article 5
attacking. Well, and let's understand what happens with Article 5. That means each country has to vote, are we going to go to war or not? And, you know, it's one thing to talk about it. You know, it's like you sitting around talking, saying, yeah, you know, I'm going to do the Ironman competition next month. Okay. But the reality is you're not prepared to do a 2 mile swim, a 26 mile run, and a 100 mile bike ride in one day. Okay. You can say, oh yeah, I'm willing to do it, but just saying it doesn't mean that you've actually got the capability to do it. And that's exactly the same kind of situation that the NATO countries are in. They're in no condition militarily to confront Russia, to actually go to war with Russia. They're absolutely not ready. And in fact, it's even questionable whether they could get ready, even if you gave them, you know, 2-3 years to get prepared.
Well, what's the resolution, Larry? What's your advice to our government, or, you know, to the public? How do we can't prepare? I don't want to go into a bunker. I don't want to come out of the bunker like the Twilight Zone episode and
right.
You know, with my books and have my glasses stepped on. I mean, you know, I don't want to be around. Get me first. I want to be in the epicenter right there, ground zero, when the first nuke hits New York City. You know, how do we avoid it right now?
Doing what you're doing. Trying to educate people, trying to warn them, speaking out as much as possible. I'm talking, Scott Ritter's talking, Rena Govern's talking, Doug McGregor's talking, Phil Giraldi's talking, Jeffrey Sachs is talking, John Mearsheimer's talking. There's a lot of voices out there.
Danny I watch Davis. All you guys, by the way, Monday and Friday, I watch you. You know, you can catch Larry, your website, Sonar 12, is that it? What is it?
Sonar 21.
Sonar 21. Yes, they can catch most of your interviews and also your speech, your incredible speech. I was there before the UN Security Council. Is that on your website? People got to take a look at that speech by you, Larry. And it's Sonar 21. People want to, they can see you in a few minutes at 4 o'clock if they go to Judge Napolitano. But don't do it, folks. You can catch him later. But he's doing an incredible job, the judge. I got to get him on this show one time. But I know you got to get prepared for that. Any last words, Larry?
Just keep warning people that we're headed towards a war with Russia that is completely avoidable, and we're the ones pushing for it.
All right. All right. Thank you very, very much, Larry Johnson. You're a true, courageous, heroic figure. And, you know, it's a real pleasure to know you. We're going to play a little bit of music and come right back with Steve Donziger and give us an update on what just happened in Colombia. This is Mercedes Sosa, right? We got Sosa?
Okay, fine.
Yeah. We'll be right back.
Cuando tenga la tierra, te lo juro, semilla, que la vida será un dulce racimo y en el mar de la tuba nuestro vino canta.
All right, that's Mercedes Sosa. That's from the concert in 84 in Nicaragua. Cuando Tengo La Tierra, and I'm sure my next guest has heard that tune before, Steve Donziger. Steve, are you there? Hello?
I am here, Randy. Thank you.
You remember great Mercedes Sosa, right?
Oh, my God. I saw her in concert in Managua in 1984.
Oh, you were there at that concert in Managua in 84. Wow.
Yes,
with Sylvia Rodriguez?
That was one of the... Oh, yeah, that was one of the best concerts I've ever been to.
Oh, my God, and the Godoy brothers, that was huge.
In the National Theater.
Yes. I mean, I have the album from that concert. It's really, somewhere, the CD or whatever. So, Steve, I know you're running around today, but I wanted to, we spoke earlier today, and give us... the insight on what happened in Colombia. I mean, I heard you tweeted out that this was one of the most significant developments regarding Chiquita Banana.
Yeah, so basically a jury in Florida just held Chiquita liable for financing death squads in Colombia. And the death squads killed several innocent people. And Chiquita was paying them essentially to run a protection racket to protect their banana farms in Colombia. And the jury imposed $38 million of damages on Chiquita, which is, frankly, not a ton of money. But the more important thing is it's the first time ever that a U.S. court has held a U.S. corporation liable for human rights abuses abroad that happened in another country. I mean, you know, I've been working on this Chevron case for years, and we've been unable to collect. So this is a very significant event. It's a victory for human rights, and it's a victory for justice. Of course, I'm sure they will appeal, and it remains to be seen if the collection will take place. But people should pay attention to this. You know, we hear a lot of bad news about the law, about the Supreme Court, about bad court decisions. Well, this is a good one, and it really does show the power of the jury system.
Right.
You know, when you give cases to regular people, they hear facts, and when judges are fair, they actually often make very good rulings. So this is a great, great example of that.
Right. Let me ask you, what's the culpability on Chiquita? I haven't even read the story yet, I'll be honest with you. Was their involvement here? The defendants,
yeah, because they were, you know, they had a huge farms or plantations, I should say, in Colombia. They were growing bananas, and it was an area of conflict. It was a conflict zone, and they were paying off these paramilitary groups that were really death squads to protect their banana plantations. But at the same time, these death squads were murdering other people for whatever reason, because they were from a rival group or they were a political threat. And they are essentially complicit by funding these death squads in these murders. So that's illegal, and that is a human rights violation for which a jury found them liable. So, you know, no one's going to jail. This is a civil case for money.
Against Chiquita. Are they United Fruit?
Still very significant.
It was back in Guatemala in the 50s, it was Chiquita, but they were part of United Fruit Company, I believe, that produced the Chiquita banana brand, but maybe I'm wrong. So it really is significant. That must have taken years for this to percolate all the way into federal or state court in Florida.
Since 2007, it's been 17 years before they could get the trial.
Well,
which is typical.
Yes,
you know,
you've been there before, right?
Yeah, right. Exactly.
All right. So quickly, you're still out there defending yourself, appealing your case. Hopefully, I see Roger Waters is asking the governor, the president, to give you a pardon.
The President Biden.
And what's your defense fund again?
It's freedonziger.com, freedonziger.com. If you go to that site, you can learn more about it. You can sign our petition, our pardon petition, and you can donate to my defense fund, which I need support to deal with all that Chevron's throwing at me. But that's where you go. FreeDonziger.com.
Steve Donziger, I love your brother. Service. I love your brother.
Love you too.
All right.
Love you too, man.
All right. We're going to play a little, we're going to be changing gears here, folks. And we've had enough serious stuff. And I'm going to go back to my days as a performer in Las Vegas. And growing up in an environment with you know the greatest entertainers of the last 100 years, I got to see and what sparked my interest in show business. And we're going to bring Pete Barbeauty, the great jazz musician slash comedian who's been on the show many times, and we're gonna play some music now and talk show business for the next hour. This is Ella Fitzgerald, by the way. This is Mac the Knife. This is the first time she sang it. You know, Bobby Darin sang it, Louis Armstrong sang it, but this is Ella singing it for the very first time, and it's I really get a kick out of this. So we're gonna play this and come back with Pete Barbeauty.
Thank you. We'd like to do something for you now. We haven't heard a girl sing it, and since it's so popular, we'd like to try and do it for you. We hope we remember all the words.